time we could have been friends, which of course is the most famous line from Baby Jane, but also really does play a lot into this episode because, wow, I mean, this show, yes, it has not been the most happy or, you know, pleasant of shows. It's been definitely, there's been some rough episodes, there really have, but especially after the Oscars, it's got progressively harder to watch, and this by far is the most tragic episode of the show. I mean, this episode was so dense, it was just so melancholy, and it felt so hopeless. Like, you knew what was, you know, actually was going to happen, and, you know, I don't really think they could have portrayed it in a way where it wasn't really sad because, you know, what the show was really trying to say. And I thought they really got the message across quite well. This was a really well done finale. I absolutely loved this finale. I think it was really, they really did a great job of wrapping everything up and just documenting everything in the best way possible. And, in the end, I was very pleased with the way this ended up wrapping up, because I really didn't know what this episode was going to be like. I was a little bit worried going into this episode, to be honest with you, because it seemed like they kind of told the story for the most part. Like, there were only a few things they really needed to do, and I was very wrong, honestly. I was very wrong. There was a lot of stuff that they still needed to show, and unlike American Horror Story Roanoke, what they showed here was very necessary and actually was very vital to the plot. And I thought, for the most part, it was definitely very well done in that regard. But, like, the documentary of the show, which I feel like is something that the show has kind of delved away from, Finale of Feud, Bette and Joan, Episode 8, You Mean All This Time We Could Have Been Friends, and I was definitely really looking forward to this finale. You know, I've really loved this show, as you know. I don't really want to say I've loved it because it's been so sad, and it's just been a show that's been, you know, two actresses really just going becoming more and more irrelevant, getting more and more downhill, and they've really been fun to watch, but wow, I mean, this episode, look, this show has never really been a fun show, but this was by far the hardest episode to watch from the show. This was a absolutely tragic finale, but I honestly think that it had to be. Like, I don't really think there's a way they could have made this finale without it being tragic, honestly. I don't really think they could have done that without that, because we know what happens to, you know, Bette and Joan. These are two actresses who, no, the story did not turn out well for them, but I think it very well does, you know, illustrate on what the show is really trying to do. You know, also the title does that very well. But, like, I was a little bit worried going into this finale, to be honest with you, because I was worried it was going to turn out like American Horror Story Roanoke, because it seemed like they had wrapped everything up in the penultimate episode, and I didn't really think that there was anything else to show, really. Well, I was very wrong, because they actually showed a lot of stuff in this finale, but let's just jump right into it, because there is really some really sad moments, but I really like the way we start off, because we start 1978 documentary. I feel the back half of the season, and that is like my main problem with the season. I don't really feel like they ever got that fully in control. Like, they never really understood how to use it to their advantage, except for literally the fifth episode. But this time, it's not Joan Blondell or Olivia de Havilland. It is actually Pauline. Pauline, you know, Aldridge's former assistant. Well, she's no longer doing that. Basically, we find out everything that she's been doing. Years ago, she moved to the Midwest, and she found her place working on documentary. So she told us she wanted to be able to go on her own, and basically, she's now working on actual opportunities for what Pauline wants to do. She wants to direct. She doesn't want to be. She could get to work with her, but seeing your idols, because, you know, they just aren't that way anymore, and they kind of scare you with the way they actually are. But the star was also softer, more vulnerable, eager to reconnect with the woman that she once dismissed and threatened to have fired. And Pauline remembers that she seemed very much tossed away. So it's not at all the Joan word that she remembers, not going on with Joan Crawford throughout this episode, that she really is just going through a huge down spiral. And I'm sorry to say that it really does not turn out well for her at all. then transition to 1969 in Joan's apartment, and she's all alone. It's really sad to see, you know, throughout the entire show, she's always had someone on her side, but she's really all alone. She's microwaving a frozen entree for one, signing old headshots and speaking to a friend on the phone about the new generation. She's making fun of Jack Nicholson and basically saying that he's cross-eyed. She turns on the television. She flips right past the news dispatches from Vietnam, but an unidentified old film that sounds like a clip from Grand Hotel makes her eyes light up. It makes her remember when things were better. As we know, you know, Joan was always obsessed with being an actress and being in the limelight, and it's very lonely for her. Again, she doesn't really have anyone to support her, and it's just really sad to see the way this was done. But luckily, you know, we do see Mama Sita. She actually does return at the door, but only on a part-time basis. She will continue to work for Joan on a part-time basis, and I like seeing that. I always like Mama Sita. I like how patient she was, and I think she realized that Joan really was all alone without her, and she gives her a new dog as well, and Joan smiles. But again, this is not exactly the same type of Joan Crawford that we've seen over the show. This Joan Crawford is just a lot less patient. She's grown very bitter. You know, she's very bitter now. She's not nearly as you know, she's not nearly as optimistic and wide-eyed as she used to be. This one, I mean, she really is decaying throughout this episode, and it's very sad to see. But we see her, she goes to the dentist's office, and we learn, basically, that because of how obsessed she was with her beauty, as a young actress, she had to have 6 back molars removed to get a shapelier, more elegant jawline, something called the buckle. And it's this bloody reminder that beauty in Hollywood is always pain, which is something that, you know, she's always, she's always endured. Which, again, it makes sense why she was that way to her kids. And, you know, because, again, she kind of thought that was acceptable behavior. And she thinks, you know, whatever keeps you young and gorgeous and able to catch the light. Because, of course, all those missing teeth have left her with terrible issues. And the young doctor suggests fitting her with a denture. But Joan's not okay with that. I mean, not for a second does she want to look, you know, anything less than beautiful. She does not want that. You know, she's always obsessed with that. And she said she'd rather spit blood into a sink than look like Martha Ray, which she actually is, we see. I mean, throughout this episode, she is spitting blood into a sink. She has cancer, and she's not willing to do anything about it. And basically, you know, he asked her, she's always obsessed with her appearance, and she says she'll stop caring about how they look when they dip her in from aldehyde, which I thought that was just a really great quote overall, just really showing how focused Joan is on that specific thing. But her agent gets in touch with her after months of radio silence. I mean, it's been so many months since Joan has done anything. Like, she's been confined in her house all this time, and it's only to tell her about this B-movie script, which is probably the worst movie that Joan Crawford ever worked on. And that's saying a lot, because as we know, her last few movies were all B-movies, but this was the pinnacle of that. And he's sure she's gonna say no to it. I mean, Joan Crawford would never take something like that. But Joan, being the desperate actress that she is, she can't say no, because she just, you know, finally gets the opportunity to relish in acting again. But that's not the reason why she takes it. Basically, the role's an anthropologist who has discovered a caveman preserved in ice, and it's called The Missing Link, and he clearly thinks that it's complete shit. But all she's hearing is Lady Scientist, which I guess she always wanted to play Marie Curie, and she feels like this is kind of her getting to do that. And again, she's not really thinking straight, she's not really being rational at this point, and she does accept an independent film, and she thinks, okay, this is finally going to put me back on top. But you can tell the second that she takes this, this is not going to turn out as well as some of the other films have. Just the way this goes, you don't think she has really any chance of this turning out successful at all. But there's also more to what he wants to give her. He also gives her this offer from Simon and Schuster for her to write a woman's lifestyle advice book. You know, just usual stuff like what her essential recipe for a dinner party, how she maintains her famous legs. And she's very skeptical, but he sells her on the endless branding opportunities. Again, anything she can do to get herself back in the limelight, she will take. Again, she doesn't care what it is. And it's just, it's really sad to see that this is what Hollywood has done to Joan. I mean, Joan Crawford would have never taken something like this, but because of how much Hollywood has consumed her, and her becoming an actress has corrupted her entire life, she doesn't see any other foreseeable, you know, she doesn't see any other answer but just to take it. So she shows up in England, and immediately you can tell she's very regretful. And I love that Joan does not hold back here. Like, you know, she's definitely done a good job of, you know, trying trying to hold back and do what she can with that, but she does not hold back for a second. She's there for the first day of shooting. The missing link has now become Trog, as in Troglodytes, which is just the beginning of the bad news. And basically, I mean, this is, like I said, it's as B-movie as you could possibly think of, and she tries to keep up with everything. It doesn't even have a budget for her dressing room. She has to do her wardrobe changes in the jump seat of a dirty van. That's how bad this all is, but she still tries to be a determined team player, and she's still, you know, talking about monologues and things like that, but unfortunately, that's not what matters here. We see she tries to keep up. We got the Doors song, The End, playing, which I thought was very appropriate because, you know, yeah, this is the end for Joan Crawford. She doesn't want to do this anymore, and there are cyber and hippies on set. They're really driving home how out of her era she really is. I mean, she is extremely out of her element here. We see her, a flask is really her only real friend. She starts to spend her nights wandering the soundstage alone, and all that diction does pay off, though. So, you know, Trog really does not go well at all. The cast really does not like her. Like I said, she's just very out of her element. This is not at all the kind of film that Joan Crawford should be doing. Everyone knows that. No one thinks this is the right kind of film for her. But all the diction does pay off, though, because Joan Crawford, My Way of Life, goes to print, and a long line of fans then show up for the book signing, which I thought was a really well-done scene. However, this is quickly cut when we see that Joan hears in their questions and compliments. You know, they're trying to compliment her, saying, oh, my mom loved you and Baby Jane. All they want to talk about is Baby Jane. And Joan is outraged, not because she's not proud of that film, but because she knows deep down that's the film that turned her into who she is today. That was the beginning of her downfall. If she had not done all she did at the Oscars, she'd probably be in a much different position right now. But because of her antics, that really set her on this path. And she knows that, and, you know, she can't even pretend not to hate what they're saying, and she, you know, basically gives them all these amazing insults that, you know, they're not gonna become this successful, and that they don't know what suffering really is, and all that kind of stuff, and you do feel bad for her, honestly. Like, they did a good job of, yeah, I mean, she did this to herself, but at this point, you can't help but feel bad for her. I mean, her career basically is gone, and she walks away back home, Manhattan, and she sees this picture of herself in the paper, and it finally leads her to a decision that is just truly tragic, especially for Joan Crawford, who was so obsessed with performing. She realizes that if the crone she sees staring back at her is who she's become, she doesn't want to be submitted for roles anymore. This is not what she should be doing anymore. She's clearly too old for it, and she's done. So yeah, Joan actually quits after so many years of pursuing picture after picture. She finally realizes that she's done, and it really is one of the most tragic parts of this episode. Not the most tragic part, but it really does show, you know, Joan's entire career relied on film, and I heard that Joan Crawford really didn't know what she was beyond a movie star, and this scene really does show that. Joan doesn't just feel like she's done with being a movie star, but she's done with her life. She doesn't really know how to continue, and for the rest of the episode, she pretty much is just relenting and regretting a lot of the things, a lot of the wrongdoings that she has committed throughout the years, which I thought was very well done. So with Joan's career basically in the tank and just done, we now see what Betty has been up to over the past several years, and Betty is not exactly in the best position either. I mean, she's doing exactly the wrong kind of stuff she should be doing, and we see it's Victor's turn to be in the documentary, and he quickly admits that Hush Hush Sweet Charlotte was not nearly as much of a success as, whatever happened to Baby Jane. He does not think that it had the charm. He does not think that Betty was as good. He doesn't think that she got the Oscar for it, but he doesn't really think that she deserved it, and he thinks that she's really lost her way, basically taking every offer that comes her way, no matter what it is. She's made 8 TV pilots. They all failed. And it was like she was just playing jingles for Lunch Meat commercials, and the worst part is that none of them ever got picked up, which is just really sad to think about. We know how much Betty cares about her craft, so for her to just, deviate away from that is just really saddening to think about. We know how much she cares about that stuff, and Betty, again, she's not really enjoying her twilight years like Katharine Hepburn, off doing Albie plays and still picking up Oscar nods, and she's kind of jealous of her, and, you know, she wishes to be her equal, and, you know, wonders how she manages it all. Like, how is Katharine Hepburn in a better position than Betty Davis? Well, it's probably because Katharine Hepburn didn't let a feud get the best of her and get in the way of everything else. Betty Davis, in fact, did. And Victor, you know, says that she sometimes says no. Betty, on the other hand, isn't saying no. She's taking every offer that comes her way no matter what, and that's really starting to tarnish her career. Now, Betty is now ash blonde. She's wearing berets, and she's in a much different position. She's constantly smoking throughout the episode, and she's really not as happy as she seems. And we then get a scene with her and BD. Now, I thought the BD was done. After last week, I thought, okay, we're not going to see her anymore. But I did like that they gave us one more scene between these two, because BD was a big part of the show. And sure, this might not be the most accurate portrayal of BD, because I did hear the BD in real life is kind of crazy. And that's not exactly what they portrayed here. But I think for the show, this character worked. Like, yeah, maybe it was not the most accurate portrayal, but I think the BD that was in this show was the BD that really worked. I thought Kieran Shipka as a whole was great. Basically, she meets her at a restaurant, and 2 minutes in, immediately, we see, you know, these two could not have more of a stark difference. BD is still married to Jeremy. She's the farm wife and mother of two boys, one of whom Betty apparently actually beat. Like, she literally beat him violently, swatted for misbehaving while she was babysitting the night before. BD also thinks her mom's a drunk. You know, we see that Betty, she just wants to try to have dinner with BD, but BD's not interested. You know, she thinks of her as just a drunk and a lost cause. And basically, you know, she's having an 11 a.m. margarita, and she lets her know she won't be staying for the guacamole or anything else in the future. She's basically just there to say goodbye. You know, she's obviously quite upset about what her mom has become. I think BD, deep down, she did love her mother, but there was only so much she could do after so many years. You know, BD and Betty really did not have the greatest relationship, and a lot of that was Betty's fault, and I think deep down she does know that. But again, this was a very tragic scene to see. I really do feel bad for Betty in this situation. You want things to get better, but you know they're just gonna get worse from here, because Betty, we see a very similar scene where Betty's at the doctor saying that she's 17 days sober, and she's also smoking like an unfiltered chimney. And the doctor thinks that basically going cold turkey on the bourbon is a mistake. But Betty insists she can't just go to rehab. You know, she's got the Dean Martin roast coming up. And the roast is the worst kind of test. Betty, you know, puts on her game face only to be demeaned and insulted by fifth-rate celebrities. And that was very hard to watch, just seeing Betty being insulted. I mean, sure, it's all fun and, you know, games, but for her, it's not. I mean, she doesn't really have much of a career left. And they're, you know, they're very unfunny jokes. And, you know, no one really deserves something like that. Sure, we have roasts every single year, but this really turned things around, where you saw, you know, that she was a victim and that she didn't really want these jokes, you know, towards her. And I thought that was very well played, that we saw that this actually was very much affecting Betty in a way you wouldn't think it would. And I thought, again, they really took something that could have been just kind of there, and they made it a lot more, you know, they gave it a lot more to the show, and I thought that was something they did very well. It's just showing how little TV gigs really had a much bigger impact than you would expect it to, and that's something the show has got done very well. So she also signs on to play the mother of sham evangelist Amy Semple in the 1976 TV movie The Disappearance of Amy. But Victor lets us know that yes, she did have many complaints about Joan, but she didn't know true hatred until she met Faye Dunaway, who, as we know, would go on to play Joan Crawford in Mommy Dearest. So most people remember Joan Crawford. And Victor's also the one who tells Bay that Joan is ill and hasn't left her apartment in months. And the second that Betty meets Faye, her whole attitude around Joan kind of changes, which I thought was honestly very well shown here, because Faye is just a mean person. Like, Joan is not a terrible person. She just let Hollywood get the best of her, and it really turned her into this monster. It really did. I mean, that is the monster that Hollywood, Jack Warner, you know, all of those creative guys, you know, they all created this monster that was not, and Joan let it get to her. You know, she didn't try to stop it. She didn't try to handle things in a more rational manner. She immediately just gave in to Hedda Hopper. She gave in to Jack Warner, and as a result, this is what it's now turned her into. And Faye Dunaway, on the other hand, is a lot more rude. She's just very vindictive, and Betty realizes that Joan actually was a great actress and that she does deserve to be respected. And then, like I said, her entire point of view for Joan really changes here, because Victor tells her how Joan is ill and she hasn't left her apartment in months, and Betty is, you know, saying that's bullshit. There's no way the cancer is gonna kill Joan. I mean, that's unheard of. You know, she'll be able to fight through it. You know, she's a cockroach just like her. But Victor still insists that she should call her, and so she does, and we get probably the most awkward scene we've had between these two so far, where Betty feels compelled to call her. She calls her, and Joan just keeps saying hello over and over. Betty hangs up the phone, and And a lot of people are wondering, why didn't Betty say something? Well, I think deep down she wanted to, but I think she knew that by doing that, she just kind of add fuel to the fire. Things are already so rough between them right now that there really is no repairing that broken friendship, which is very sad to think about. You could tell she really wanted to, but there really is no repairing it, and there's nothing else really she can do there. So we then go all the way to 1977, and Joan's daughter Kathy comes to visit with her own kids, and to be told that her mother doesn't want chemo, and she's a Christian Scientist now. And Joan also knows that her eldest daughter Christina is writing a book. Now, this book would essentially ruin Joan's career. That's Mommy Dearest, the book that was very much a tell-all book full of hatred, full of a lot of one-sided type scenarios. And you know, Joan says that they have to understand that she was at the height of her career when she was little. They didn't have the quality time that she had with her and Sydney. You know, she worked so hard instilling the proper values in her. She only wanted to appreciate her advantages, and that's true. Joan always focused on being an actress. That's all she really focused on. And basically, they ask if she wants to read the galleys like the editor offered, and she says she does not. And basically, they tell her to spend the rest of the days of her life reading something that could only hurt her. You know, why would she want to do that and, you know, forget wire hangers? She's now fine with, and she's so out of her element. She's okay with her grandchildren's scuff marks on the floor. Like, she doesn't care at this point. She's, this woman is dying, and she doesn't even realize it. And she also just wants one daughter's reassurance, and she actually gets it. Kathy tells her that she was the best mom in the world, and it really does make her happy. And I love the way that scene was done, that at least finally, after so many years, she did get some sort of acceptance from her children. Now, her and Christina obviously would never be the same again, obviously, after she wrote that tell-all book. But at least Kathy did appreciate her into the family. I thought that was also really well done. But now we get to the most controversial scene of this episode, which I think a lot of people are definitely going to be talking about. I thought it worked really well for the show, but I know a lot of people are very back and forth with how they feel, and let's just get into it. Because for me, this was a scene that was very important. I think this scene was definitely there because they wanted to give us that closure. You know, there's a lot more they can do in the TV show that they can't do, that didn't happen in real life. And Joan has this basically fantasy sequence, you know, how people, when they get older, sometimes they start to see visions and they start to have recall fond memories. Well, that's what Joan's doing here. She wakes in the middle of the night, and she's woken up by the sound of a celebration in the living room. And it's a fake Hedda Hopper and a fake Jack Warner. They're all dressed up and drinking martinis. They're playing cards by candlelight. And they're all just laughing about, you know, times that they've had. And suddenly Joan is in pink Sean Tang 2 white gloves. And she looks like she did, you know, when she first did Whatever Happened to Baby Jane. And basically, they're all playing the game of who had it harder in Hollywood. And Hedda had her 100 Years War with her fellow communist Luella Parsons. Joan never stopped fighting for what should have been hers. Jack apparently was a Jew, and he says that the expression isn't unite and conquer. And basically, she asks why she would need to be conquered. And then we get to the big stuff when Betty does enter this scene. But it's not a war of words, actually. It turns out to be a lot better than you think, basically. You know, she looks very young, and basically she asks them to tell Joan what they did to her, and, you know, says that it's her fault. And Joan dully confesses her deepest insecurities, that if she ever showed the real girl beneath the movie star, Venner, she could have gone back to that sad little wretch that she had been. If she just showed that she wasn't this big actress and actually, you know, acted as her own, as Lucille, she could maybe have had a better life. But she spent her whole life being Joan Crawford, a woman she created for others, and she didn't know who she was when she was by herself, which is crazy to think about. But because she just, you know, invested so much time into playing essentially a character of herself, she doesn't really know who she is when she's not acting. You know, when she's by herself, she doesn't know really what to think of herself, which is very interesting. But they all agree to apologize on the count of three, and basically, Hedda and Jack go away, and basically, Betty tells her that if she had really known how hard it was, you know, she wouldn't, and Jack basically lets her know that if he had known how hard it was for her, he wouldn't have done one thing differently. And I thought that was pretty funny to see all of that, and basically says they feel the anger that they feel from not being loved, which is the reason that they're still in this business in the first place. All the tears and the screaming and the rage, it all disappears, and the public, what they remember for the most part is the good stuff, the work and all the joy that they brought them. They're not going to remember the feud that, you know, was the main conflict going on with the show. What we have to remember is that Bette and Joan were great actresses, and that's what they really wanted to do. They spent so much time in their careers trying to pursue acting roles. And the most important part of the scene, though, is after Jack and Hedda leave, because Bette basically tries to apologize to Joan, and we get them finally making amends, which I thought made sense. They never actually did this in real life. You know, they never actually got to make amends completely. But they talk about how much they like Young and the Restless and why bother the Guggenheim. And Joan wonders why she's so happy to see Bette. And Bette says just nostalgia. And Joan admits that she's sorry she wasn't more generous with Bette. And basically she wishes she had been a better friend to her. And Joan says that they can start now. But of course, it's just too late. She can't have that life with Joan. I think deep down, you know, at the end of her life, she's realizing that she could have done things a lot differently. She could have handled this in a much more delicate manner, and this whole feud did not really need to happen. A lot of it was just over jealousy, and it was over the pain that they weren't like the other. Joan didn't have, you know, the talent that Bette had, and Bette did not have the talent that Joan, and Bette did not have the looks that Joan had. That was something that always bothered them, and she calls him Mamacita for champagne, and that, of course, is how the illusion finally fades away. Mamacita tells her that this is all a dream. She's alone getting her nightgown on her plastic-covered couch, and Mamacita says it all. She puts her charge gently back to bed. Joan understands, but she's still grateful and glad for what she had. And that, my friends, is the last time we see Joan well and alive on this show, which is very sad to see. It was a very well-done end to everything, with Joan finally realizing, you know, what she had done wrong and what she needed to go back on. But the thing is, she can't change that. You know, it is what it is, and it really has affected her because of that. And it's very sad to think that if maybe they just said things differently, this all could have been resolved, and they could be in a much different position than they are. So, 1 week later, Mamacita is on the documentary, says that Joan is dead, and basically that they embalmed her. They made her look the way she did, the way that she wanted to, and then they cremated her body. And the documentary crew interviewing her prompts to talk about how big the funeral was, and how the studios even observed a moment of silence for their once great star. But Mamacita's not moved. She's not there to give them all of this publicity and let them know all of these rumors. You know, she just wants to tell a story. She really, I think, deep down cared about Joan, and they showed up to say goodbye, but not when Joan was still alive. They really need their company. And Bette learns the news from a reporter's phone call, and basically, if you think that was shocking to her, you know, that Joan got cancer, realizing that she's actually dead, she doesn't know what to do. I mean, you know, basically, she even says that she doesn't want to talk badly about the dead, and all she says is that Joan is dead, good, we'll stitch that on a pillow and call it Lucille. And you can just see her face is starting to turn to, you know, it's really not, you know, she's very much regretting a lot of what happened between her and Joan, realizing that maybe she could have helped her, maybe she could have made things better for her. And it's just really sad to think about that she has all these regrets at the end of her life. But she does get a sent a stash of old letters that her mother wrote, and they're petty and mean, and the daughter recalled in them is a selfish, bratty pain in the ass, and Bette feels very betrayed. You know, she thought that her mother was her only friend, when in reality, her mother actually hated her, which, I mean, again, just, it's so sad, but that's what actually happened. And in the end, we see she ends up going to Margot, who really is the only thing that Bette has to actual family, someone who stuck by her. But what's so sad, as we know, is that Margot does not register anything that Bette is saying to her because of the condition that she has. And anytime that Bette is talking to her, Margot just, it doesn't penetrate. And it's just, it's really sad to see. But then we go to 1978 and the Oscars, and Bette is there to present to Charlton Heston, and Olivia wants her to sit down with the film crew when she's done for the forever ongoing framing device slash documentary about Joan, but Bette won't bite. She does not want to appear on that because she doesn't want to be involved with all the rumors, and, you know, basically she doesn't want to just revisit her talk show archives. There's plenty of meat on Joan there. there. She's had enough of this endless and incomprehensible fixation, and she feels that people should just move on. Like, just remember Joan as a great actress, and don't remember all of the petty conflicts that those two were involved in. And Olivia insists it's not a film about Joan, it's a film about all of their lives. And I mean, that's true. This was never just about Joan, it was about Olivia, it was about, you know, Betty, it was about Aldridge, it was about Jack, it was about all of them. And basically, Betty says that, you know, he wants her to say funny, bitchy one-liners about Joan Crawford, and she's not going to do that. She just is not going to talk badly about her. She's done it all her life, and a lot of people said this was a show contradicting themselves, but I didn't see it that way. I saw it as Betty realizing, you know, she's done this all her life, and she wants to finally move on from it. You know, finally just remember Joan as a great actress, so she can go on with her life and not have all these regrets, even though she is very much having regrets. And basically, we see at the very end, we see a memoriam of Joan at the Oscars, and it goes on for 5 seconds, basically. You know, it goes on for 5 seconds, and Joan Blondell, you know, she's outraged that, holy shit, you know, Joan Crawford made all these movies, and all they gave her is 5 seconds. But what Betty says here, I think, is a very important line. It really shows what the show is trying to say, and that we all have 5 seconds. That's it. All we have are those last 5 seconds, and then we're gone. You know, everyone, we're irrelevant because we're dead, and that's how it's going to work. And it's a very cynical way of looking at things, but it's true. I mean, you only have so much time left in Hollywood. That's exactly what happened to Betty and Joan. They just faded out of obscurity, and that's why they're remembered for this, basically. And we see one last scene of the documentary crew, and the woman wants to know what really happened when Betty and Joan came together the first day on the set. And we see the flashback to the first day on the set, and they're sitting side by side on the set, and everything's great. Actually, things are going great for them. You know, they're laughing about what happened, and they're laughing, you know, they're just having fun times, they're bonding as mothers and things like that. It seems like everything is great for them. But Joan has a promise for Betty and tells her that when all of this is said and done, she really hopes that she's made a new friend, and Betty agrees. And as we know, that's not the case at all. That's not all what happened. But really, we realize that these two just wanted to be really great friends, which is very sad to think about. But that is not the way that this episode ends, because we do get a, you know, where are they now sort of thing, like they did for Pee Wee versus OJ, which I thought was very smart of them to do. But we find out what everyone did. Basically, Bob Aldridge went on to direct the 1967 smash hit The Dirty Dozen. Jack retired in 1969, and he died in 78 at 86, and basically Victor found success as King Tut on TV's Batman. He died at 43 of a heart attack on New Year's Day, 1982. BD became a born-again Christian and wrote this 1985 book about Betty that estranged them for the rest of their lives because of how ashamed she really was of her mother, which honestly, you can't really blame her for. I mean, Betty did not have, you know, they really did not have that great of a relationship, which I think Betty really did want to have, but she was just too laser-focused on her daughter, and she didn't want her daughter to have to grow up. And Olivia is actually the only one that's still alive. She's 100 years old. She's still going strong in Paris. Hedda died in 1966 at 80, and Joan never lived to see the character assassinating release of her daughter's book and the ensuing film, but her friends, family, and colleagues at least dispute its version of events. Betty, we find out, probably had the most tragic end of it all. She was diagnosed with breast cancer, and she had a mastectomy, and then 4 strokes, which actually left her left side paralyzed, and until the end, she smoked up to 100 cigarettes a day, even though that doctor told her not to. She did, and she finally passed away in France in 1989, and her epitaph basically says that she did it the hard way, and that's how she went out. And that is how this show finally comes to an end. Really, really satisfying stuff overall, but let's just get into this and where I think, you know, what I thought of this season as a whole. So, overall, guys, there's really not much to say about this finale because, I mean, it's over. You know, we saw both Betty, we know how both Betty and Joan are gonna die. We saw it all end, and I really thought this was very satisfying. But what I really loved about this finale that I really took away from it is the message of it all. I did not expect the message to be what it really was, but it is definitely a very important message. And I think Ryan Murphy was very smart to include this in there because, sure, a lot of the show has been about sexism, and it's been about, you know, what Hollywood can do to someone, and, you know, what people will do for fame and how far stars will go, and, you know, the idea of obscurity. But what this episode really was about, and I think what it was really trying to shed some light on, is respect your elders. You know, those people that are very old, And, you know, they're a little, maybe they're just, they don't have as much strength, or they have a lot of, you know, they have a lot of, maybe they have a deformity, or they're crippled. They had a story, and they had a life, and you want to remember all the good things they did rather than the bad. And I think it's a very important message. We should not remember Bette Davis and Joan Crawford for their personalities, but for them as actors, that they were great actresses, and they worked as much as they could to preserve their craft and make sure their craft could go on. And even though Joan was so focused on her looks, she still did whatever she could to get a part. Betty, I mean, did 8 pilots and none of them worked out. I mean, that really is dedication, and that's something they really did show at the end of this all, and I thought that was very well represented here. But as a whole, I really did love this finale. I thought it was extremely well done, and if I had to grade the finale of Feud, Betty and Joan, I would definitely give this finale a 4.5, a 4.75 out of 5, or an A. I think this was extremely well done. It was very hard to watch at times, specifically the scenes with Joan, you know, and Mama Seats and everything that happened there. I just thought all of that was definitely very sad to see, the way that all turned out. But in the end, I thought it was a very satisfying end. I don't think they really could have ended it better. They really did wrap everything up perfectly, and I was very impressed with the way the finale turned out. But now let's talk about the season, because wow, did this show surprise me. I remember I thought the show was going to be very, very cheesy and very over the top. And sure, at points it was, definitely, but it also stayed very grounded in reality, and it felt like this is very well what could have happened. And sure, maybe Jessica Lange's voice, you know, she was in and out of an accident at points. Maybe that wasn't exactly how Joan Crawford sounded. Maybe Susan Sarandon wasn't exactly how Bette Davis sounded, but they worked their damnedest, and they did it to their full ability, and you really believed what Joan Crawford wanted and what Bette Davis wanted. And what I love is that they never really picked sides in the show. They never were saying, you should side with Betty or Joan. It was always, here's what Betty won, here's what Joan won, and here's why it's so similar. What they won a lot of times was very similar. You know, Betty wanted to be an actress, Joan wanted to be an actress, but they wanted separate things. Betty wanted to have good looks, Joan wanted to be, you know, a great actress. And they were always jealous that that was the one, you know, flaw that each of them didn't have. You know, everyone does have that flaw, and that's something that the show, again, very well did touch upon. But also the way the show recreated various historical events was extremely well done. I mean, they got it down to a T most of the time. Just what Ryan Murphy did with the Oscars was incredible. I loved what he did there. The attention to detail is just astounding in that show. That's something that definitely very much did impress me. But also the way that they would get the show to focus on some of the other characters, like Aldridge, you know, how they actually get us to care for Aldridge, even though he wasn't the greatest guy. Deep down, I mean, he just wanted to make films, and he didn't want to be committed to TV all his life, and he is remembered to be a great director, you know, for a various number of films. You know, Jack Warner was kind of a dick. Hedda Hopper, that was very well portrayed. Your Mamacita. And even the inclusion of Pauline. Pauline was an original character, but I thought she worked very well here. You know, I always wanted that success for Pauline, so I was happy she went on to do, you know, success and things like that. Just all of that was so compelling. There was never an episode that I wasn't into. There was never an episode that I thought was boring. Every episode of the show I really did love. I think they really got the idea of, you know, what Hollywood can do to someone and what happens when Hollywood really does get in the way of your entire life. They got that down perfectly, and I think it really did help the show because of that. Like I said, really my only fault with this show, one is pacing. I do think some things they could have spent a little bit more time on. Like, honestly, they could have spent more time on whatever happened to Baby Jane. They really could have. I get it that they want to focus more on the feud part of it all, and I understand that. But I feel like they could have focused just a little bit more on that, because it was really only 2 episodes that we saw them in whatever happened to Baby Jane. And then just kind of wrapped up, and then the show became more about their successes, which I thought worked. I just felt like the majority of the show, we could have seen a little bit more of that. You could have still put the Oscar episode in the same place, but I just wanted a little bit more with Baby Jane, to be honest with you. But the main thing was the documentary. I never really understood the true point of it. I get it now what they were trying to do, but I just felt like it was such an afterthought. Like, it felt like, oh yeah, the documentary's back. Oh yeah, the documentary's back. Never was there a thing in my mind that said, oh, that really needs to be there. We really needed this documentary. And sure, it gave us a great performance from Kathy Bates. It gave us a great performance from Catherine Zeta-Jones. They were great in those roles. But I just kept thinking, do we really need this? Like, do I really need all this information from Bette Davis, or could I easily have just looked it up myself? Like, it felt like a lot of times the show was just kind of forcing you information. It felt like it was kind of, it felt like homework at times. It really did. And a show should never feel like homework, but there were points in the show where it did feel the way. And I think that's something that the show did have a problem with, is that it did become very fact-based when it came to the documentary. And I feel like they could have done just a little bit more with the documentary if they really wanted to shed some light on Joan and Betty. I think they did a good job with the overall narrative, but it's just the documentary stuff was just a bit clunky to me. And because that, it did overall lower my thoughts on the season. But this season was still fantastic, guys. Ryan Murphy is really knocking it out of the park lately. This show really does show what can happen when he shows what he's truly capable of, when he really commits himself fully to something. This is everything he can do. I mean, this is incredible. What he was able to get at here was he was able to get, it's just, it seems impossible that the show turned out as well as it did, but it really did turn out, I think, really as great as it possibly could, and I was very happy with well, besides documentary stuff, I was very happy with the way this show did turn out in the end. This might be on my list of favorite shows of the year. I'm not sure if it will, but overall, guys, I really did love Feud, Bette and Joan, and I am going to give the season of Feud, Bette and Joan I would probably give the season a 4.5 out of 5 or an A-. Like I said, very, very close to perfect, but because the documentary aspect is the only thing that really did lower the show. Other than that, guys, this is one of Ryan Murphy's best achievements. It really to show what happens when he puts his heart and soul into something. It told a very compelling story. It never really got too over the top. It stayed very grounded in reality, was compelling the whole time, but now they really do have big shoes to fill. I know they're going to be doing a season 2, and I don't know if it's really going to live up to this, but definitely whoever he cast, they have really big shoes to live up to because of the acting, the dedication, and just the hard work that was put into this. I'm really hoping that hard work is put into Ryan Murphy's other shows, because again, this really does show what happens when he just has full creative control over everything, and he actually knows what he wants to do. By limiting the characters, by limiting on, by telling a more fact-based story, he was able to make this more ground reality, and I think that's the kind of stuff Ryan Murphy needs to do. Get away from American Horror Story, focus more on this stuff. This is exactly your calling, and I really do hope that he takes this show to heart, because this is exactly the kind of show I want to continue see him doing. So, overall, guys, that's it. Feud, Bette and Joan is now over. I can't believe how fast the show has flown by, but I really love the show. Thank you guys for sticking with me for the last 8 weeks for all of the reviews. I definitely will be reviewing next season. I don't know exactly who's going to play Charles and Diane. It's a different concept, so we'll have to see the way that all turns out. But that's my review. Hope you guys enjoy it, and we'll see you guys in my next video, which will be for the final episode of Bates Motel. I can't believe it. Bates Motel's ending tonight. Holy shit, there's so many shows ending at once. But, yeah. Bates Motel is ending, and I will see you guys for that. Okay, bye.